Hello, my name is Gwen Bart, and I'm from the University of Idaho in the United States. And I have really enjoyed hearing all the talks at this conference about the different aspects of the lunar surface. So I'm going to continue that and talk about regolith depths on the moon. So the lunar surface is covered in regolith. And by regolith here, I am referring to the loose layer of broken up rocks that covers the surface of the moon that is formed primarily by meteorite impact. And so here you can see, this is a schematic from a paper by Wilcox in 2005, and it's just a cross section of the regolith. And what I wanted to show you here was a couple different things. So regolith is primarily formed by meteorite impact. And so because of the nature of meteorite impact, the first point I want to make is that the regolith itself is not a consistent depth over a surface. It's going to be highly variable because of the variable nature of where the impacts occur and how large they are. So for instance, here in the middle, you can see there's an area here that doesn't have much bedrock, whereas over here, the bedrock comes up much closer to the surface. And that's one important point to keep in mind toward the end of my presentation. And then the second point I want to make is that the lunar regolith primarily grows as a result of impacts that are large enough to excavate below the existing regolith. So here in the middle, where you have a regolith that is already deeper, if you have an impact like this, it will serve to churn the regolith and cause fresh material perhaps to come to the surface, but it won't actually make the regolith get any deeper. And in order to actually make the regolith get deeper, you're going to need an impact that actually comes down and excavates more of that solid rock out from underneath the surface to get to the top. So because of this, the lunar regolith is going to get deeper as you have impacts that excavate beneath the existing regolith. And we know that impacts are occurring to this very day. And so the conclusion from this is what I have started calling the depth age hypothesis, which is that older surfaces should have thicker regoliths than younger surfaces. And on this next slide, I have the same text, but I've added a bunch of references to show you that this is not something I'm just making up. Shoemaker and Morris, of course, back in the day in 1970, and have multiple papers about the lunar regolith justifying why it should be considered to be formed primarily by impact, and that the regolith depth will grow as you get impacts that are big enough to excavate beneath the existing regolith. And there are lots and lots of papers. These are just some example ones. And including up to this day, I highlighted the paper here by Hirabayashi in 2018. Who also makes this specific assertion. And then the second point, that impacts continue to this day. Of course, Malin in 2006 used the Mars Orbiter camera to show that there have been new impacts forming since in the present day. And then Dalbar in 2013, and as well, she has a new paper in 2022. More new impacts, thousands of new impacts have been discovered on Mars. And Spire in 2016 has a paper about new impacts on the moon. And there are several other papers about that too, coming from the LRO team. And so this conclusion is not also a new conclusion from me. This conclusion is a conclusion that's been put forth by people back from the 1960s up to the present day. So I'm going to show you some of the data that supports this depth age hypothesis. So this is one of the older data sets. This is by Oberbeck and Quaid in 1968. And they used the lunar orbiter data to divide different lunar orbiter images into different regolith or different surface types. And so they said they did some crater counting, and that they, although they were not specific about how or why or what those details were. But they said type 1 is the least cratered surface, so it should be the youngest. Type 2 is more cratered. Type 3 is more cratered. Type 4 has the most craters. And then they used a particular method to determine regolith depth on each of these crater surface types. And they found, in fact, that regolith depths increase with surface age. So this plot very clearly supports the depth age hypothesis. And you look at that and you're like, yes, okay, this is good. But since then, obviously, crater counting has totally taken off and become a very detailed and precise thing that everyone's working on to try to get ages for surfaces on the moon that are as precise as we can get. So here's one example of Hessinger in 2011, who has, again, there's a whole series of papers that they put together where they have measured ages for these various Mari surfaces. And so you can see that there are some Mari surfaces that are much older than 3.5 billion years. There are quite a number of the blue ones that are around 3 billion years old. And then there's fewer, but there's still a few of Mari surfaces with ages of 2 billion years and even younger. So what I did is I went back and I took this Overbeck and Quade data, and they had listed which lunar orbiter images they had used. So I went and compared that with the locations of these Hessinger Mare to get actual ages for the surfaces where they took their data. And then I replotted it to see what it looked like. So here you can see, once again, you have regolith depth on the y-axis here. And so these are the regolith depths that Overbeck and Quade had measured. But when you take each of the ages of the various lunar orbiter surfaces and you plot those regolith depths where they go, you can see that there's a wide range of these type two surfaces that they found, and it covers a wide range of ages. And that here around 2.5, there's actually a stack up of a wide range of regoliths at the same age. So this is kind of an interesting plot. It's no longer clear whether this data really supports the depth age hypothesis so much. So in fact, other authors since Overbeck and Quade have also claimed that their regolith depth measurements also support the depth age hypothesis. And here's four papers spanning kind of wide range of dates over the last 50 or so years. The Nakamura data in the upper left is the seismic data from the Apollo seismic experiment on the moon. And then the BART 2011 is the work I had done on comparing regolith depths on the near side versus the far side. And then there are a couple more data sets down lower. The FA data, they studied four different lava flows in Sinus Iridium. And the D paper used actually a slightly different method using topography to measure regolith depths. And so all of these papers stated to some extent that, yes, look, our data show an increasing regolith depth with age. But if you look here, you can see that the regolith depths, they're all greater. Well, they're not a real tight correlation. Let's put it that way. And I'm running out of time, so I'm going to move on and just show you this is my main plot. I put all this data together on one plot to see what it looks like, because I thought, well, maybe things will be clearer, because a lot of these other plots, you know, they have like five data points, and that's kind of hard to tell what you're doing. So here we put it all together. And indeed, we see that, okay, at the youngest surface on this plot, it's a lower regolith depth. And yes, there are two high regolith depths over here at large age. But for the most part, most of this data seems to fall within a box that's between about 3 meters regolith depth and 8 meters regolith depth. And in the end, I would say this is actually a really good correlation. It says all these people have used extremely different methods for how to find the regolith depth, and they all found something between 3 and 8. I mean, that's pretty good because the regolith depth is highly variable on each surface. But we're not seeing, I would say, a very clear trend of the regolith depth clearly increasing with age. So in conclusion, it seems like theoretically, given our understanding of how we think the regolith forms, the older surfaces should have thicker regoliths than younger surfaces. But it's not clear that the existing data support that hypothesis. So why is this? That is a very good question. And we are continuing to collect new data, and we hope to have another paper coming out maybe this fall. I have a graduate student working with me, Elizabeth Atang, who's taking some new data. And we're hoping to better understand what is going on and why the existing data may not be properly, be clearly showing us a trend of increasing depth with age. Thank you very much.